to invite Admi to give a talk about aptamer imaging. So in contrast to antibody, aptamer imaging is an imaging field, so there is less results. And aptamer, when I talk about aptamer, I would like to talk about nucleic acid aptamers, not peptide aptamers, because sometimes you could it's confused. So nucleic acids, as you may know, are not only a single strain like that, unstructured. It's much more something like that. All the RNA in cells have a very rich structure, and they have very rich structure because they could make hydrogen bonds, electrostatic bonds, van der Waals interaction, and hydrophobic interaction. And this structure of nucleic acids are used in cells to make interaction with proteins, with small compounds, and also catalytic activities. You have to remind that the ribosome, it's 80% of RNA in the cells, and it's to make catalytic activities. And what is a nucleic acid aptamer? In fact, it's a 3D structure of oligonucleotide that is selected by a process of directed molecular evolution to bind to a specific target. This process is mostly known as SELEX technology. It means systematic evolution of ligands by exponential enrichment. And this technology appears in the 90s. So why do we talk about directed molecular evolution? It's because, in fact, we use to select an aptamer all the rules of evolution described by Darwin for the evolution of animal species. It means that it's struggle for life. In a population, only a fraction of species accessing the food will survive. And to survive, it's a natural procession selects. It means that it's depending of the heredity of all the species to have the adaptation. And finally, during succession generation, you could have a process that gradually changes the population and promotes the apparition of new species with even better structure to be adapted to the food. And all these rules described by Darwin for the evolution of animal species are used at a molecular level to select aptamer. So the first step to select an aptamer is to build a DNA library that will have at each extremity a known sequence to perform PCR amplification and a random sequence in the center. So during the synthesis of DNA, chemical synthesis, for instance here, we inject in the synthesizer a C, and all the sequence will incorporate a C. Then we wash, we incorporate at this position a mix of different base, and so in that case, some sequence will incorporate a the other a T, other a C, and other a G, etc. And if we do that several times, n time, we could potentially generate 4 power n different sequences. But there is a limit. If you want to manipulate all the possibility of 100 base, it means that you would like to manipulate 10 power 60 different sequences. It's corresponding to the mass of the Earth. So it's not possible. So usually the experimental limit is 10 power 14 to 10 power 15 different sequences. But it's a quite high diversity. After, when you have this library, the basic is you incubate this library with the target of choice. It could be a protein or small compound or plastic or whatever. And then you postulate that in your pool, some structure of DNA or RNA could have a structure that could interact with your target. And then by a partition, like filtration, chromatography, or whatever, you separate this aptamer that bind the target from all the rest of the pool. You recover this sequence. You could amplify them. If it is RNA, you make RT-PCR. If it is DNA, you just make PCR. And during this step, you could have some mutation. And after, if it is RNA, you make in vitro transcription, and you recover a new pool that is enriched in binder for your target. And so, during round one of in vitro selection, you have the famous struggle for life. Only the one that have a structure could adapt to bind the target will survive. They could be reproduced. And during the reproduction, you could have apparition of new species by mutation. And if this mutation lead to aptamer with the highest affinity, they will be selected and enriched progressively. And so the repetition of selection and amplification lead progressively to enrich your pool in good binder to your target. And after, since it's DNA, you just have DNA or RNA, and you just have to sequence to identify the aptamer. So now, for molecular imaging, most of the time in the past, aptamer were developed in DNA chemistry, in DNA chemistry or in RNA chemistry, because it's natural base that could be incorporated by polymerase. However, this chemistry is not really resistant to nucleases. That could be a problem for in vivo application. So there is different way to improve the resistance to nucleases, changing the chemistry of nucleic acids. So the first possibility is to select aptamer in the natural conformation, natural chemistry, but against an enantiomer of a target. In that case, if you identify this kind of aptamer, if you synthesize the enantiomer of the aptamer in LDNA or LRNA, that is non-natural enantiomeric form of oligonucleotide, this enantiomer of aptamer will be able to bind the natural target. But since it's unnatural base, they are not recognized by nucleases, and so you have a sequence that will be completely resistant. It's so you could synthesize in that case LDNA or LRNA aptamer, and there is a famous company known Noxon in Germany that commercialized that as the name Spiegelmer. The other possibility is to use modified based that could be incorporated by nucleases, like 2' fluoro, 2' O-methyl, phosphorothioate, or LNA-based. And in that case, you increase the resistance against nucleases. So depending on the chemistry, you have different advantages or drawbacks. So DNA, the main advantage of DNA, it's really cheap. It's a few dollars for milligrams. And it's easy to label because you could make chemical synthesis. Drawbacks, it's medium resistance to nucleases. RNA aptamer are not well developed for molecular imaging because their resistance to nucleases is quite nothing. But the main advantage of this chemistry, you could introduce that inside cells to make reporter genes or something like that. 2' fluoropyrimidine RNA, it means that the 2' position of only pyrimidine is modified to resist to nuclease, and the purine is unmodified, but it's increased the resistance to nucleases. Main drawback, it's much more expensive than DNA, and the chemical synthesis is much more difficult. It means that if you want to produce them by chemically synthesized, you have to reduce the size of your aptamer. The other chemistry, 2' methyl phosphorothioate LNA, it's increased the resistance, it's much more expensive than DNA, and for moment, it's an emerging in the field of aptamer. There is little use of this kind of chemistry. And concerning LDNA or RNA, it's very nice for the resistance of nucleases. The main drawback is you need to synthesize an enantiomer of your target. And it's not really possible for big proteins. It's much more dedicated to small peptides. So, aptamer have been selected against a high different kind of targets, from small compound, peptide, nucleic acid structure, proteins, and now there is a lot of aptamers that are selected directly against virus, cells, parasites, also fixed tissue from patient. And there is two papers describing the in vivo biopanning of aptamer in mouse model of tumor, and also for aptamer that could be able to target brain. What are the advantages of aptamer? The affinity and specificity is quite similar to antibody or phage display. It's even maybe better than peptide found by phage display. They could inhibit most of the time their target. It means that they could sometimes be translated to inhibitors. They have very high stability depending on the chemistry. The stability against nucleases is higher or not. But they have very high stability also for thermal denaturation. It means that you could boil DNA for hours without any trouble. You could put them in acidic pH, in basic pH. They don't care. So it means that for chemical labeling or chemical conjugation, it's quite interesting. They could be chemically synthesized. It could reduce considerably the cost for production and increase the possibility of labeling and conjugation. And for in vivo application, one of the main advantages is that the lack of immunogenicity. It means that you don't have the trouble that you have with antibody, where you have to immunize antibody or this kind of engineering. With aptamer, you could use your aptamer in mouse or in human or every species without any trouble. And they could be produced against extracellular targets that are easier to access for in vivo imaging. Now, there is several different applications for aptamer. Aptamer have been developed for tool for research for people studying interaction between nucleic acids and proteins, but also to develop a kit like ELISA with antibody using aptamer. They are used also to purify proteins, cells, like immunoprecipitation. They are used also in therapy. There is only one aptamer that has been approved by FDA. It's the Macugen for the treatment of macular disease. And there is several interesting demonstrations that aptamer could be good targeting agent of siRNA and nanoparticle for therapeutic effect. And in diagnostic, there is several works to use aptamer for biosensor, biochips, and some now paper have described the use of aptamer for in vivo molecular imaging. So how could we use aptamer for in vivo molecular imaging? Of course, we will need to label the aptamer with a contrast agent, and the aptamer will be used to address this contrast agent to a specific target. For the labeling of oligonucleotides, there is different possibilities. The first possibility is conjugation at what extremity of the aptamer if you introduce a reactive group at one extremity. It could be an amino group, thiol group, acid, alcine, etc. In that case, the main advantage, it's regioselective. The limits, it needs chemical synthesis of your aptamer. So it's really possible with DNA aptamer, less possible for other chemistry, except if you reduce the size of your aptamer to 30-40 based. The other possibility is random labeling of base using a psoralen acylating agent or cisplatin derivative. In that case, you could make cross-link of your contrast agent to the base of your aptamer. It's random labeling. So the main advantage is it's easy labeling. It could be used with any chemistry of aptamer. The limit, it could reduce the affinity of your aptamer because modifying some base could be a problem for the structure of your aptamer, and you could lose the affinity sometime of your aptamer. It could also introduce much more than one contrast per aptamer, so it could be a problem sometimes, especially for fluorescence imaging, because you could have possible auto-quenching effect. And the last possibility, that is a nice possibility with oligonucleotide, it's you could elongate your aptamer with a sequence, and you could use a complementary sequence that is labeled with a contrast agent, and you just make an hybridization. And in that case, you could easily label your aptamer. So it's easy, it could be used with any chemistry. It just needs to elongate the aptamer, but it's not a so big limit. Now, aptamer has proved for molecular imaging what kind of target could we use. We could target proteins that are present in the intravascular space or attached to the endothelium, but also proteins that are present in the extracellular matrix, proteins that are expressed at the surface of cells, and the intracellular space is quite impossible because nucleic acids do not travel through the plasmic membrane. So the first use of aptamer for in vivo imaging have been published by Charlton and collaborators. They use an aptamer that was directed against neutrophil elastase, and this aptamer was elongated to hybridize with another sequence that was linked to an inhibitor of the elastase, and there was a labeling at the extremity with a chelator to make technetium labeling. And they use this aptamer to have an imaging of inflammation. Here there was an inflammation in the forelimb of a rat, and you could see here the signal during time with a control aptamer in contrast to a control position with no inflammation. And here you could see there was a little increase with the aptamer of the signal, and here it's a comparison with an antibody. And so there was a higher contrast with the aptamer in contrast to the control sequence and to the antibody. It was the first proof that aptamer could maybe be used for molecular imaging. Following this work, another group by Hicke and colleagues published the use of aptamer against tenascin C to image a tumor. So tenascin C is a protein of the extracellular matrix that is overexpressed in some cancer. In that case, they use different kind of labeling to introduce chelator. And they could demonstrate a very nice contrast in a tumor in comparison of a non-binding sequence control. And they have to wait 3 hours to have a nice contrast, and it stays for a long time. So you could see that the tumor blood ratio was very high and very quick. And interestingly, they demonstrate also that the labeling have a high impact on the biodistribution of your aptamer. Because they demonstrate that if they use a Mag2 technetium chelator, in that case your aptamer have a high elimination by intestinal tract, in contrast to the two other chelators where they have higher elimination by the kidney. So it dramatically affects the biodistribution of your aptamer. And some chelators were better than others for the tumor targeting. Now, instead of SPECT imaging, other people also published the use of aptamer for fluorescence imaging, like she and collaborators, that make a labeling of a DNA aptamer with a cyanine. And this aptamer was directed against Ramos cells tumors. And when they made a xenograft in a nude mouse, in contrast to cyanine alone or cyanine conjugated to a control sequence, there was no signal in the tumor. There was quite a nice signal in the tumor with the aptamer. There was something missing here, but another interesting thing with aptamer is that since there are made of oligonucleotide, it's well known that oligonucleotide could be used to build molecular probes that are named beacon probes. It means that it's a special way to have fluorescent activatable probes. In that case, you have an aptamer that have a structure, you elongate this aptamer with a sequence, and at each extremity, 5' and 3', you put a fluorophore and a quencher. And in that case, this aptamer is not fluorescent. But when it interacts with its target, in that case, the structure of the aptamer changes, and the fluorescent probes is driving out from the quencher, and so you have emission of fluorescence. And she used this kind of strategy, and he could compare the signal in a mouse of an aptamer probe that was not quenched, it was completely on, and so you could see a tumor targeting, the tumor was there, but it's not so easy to see the signal in the tumor in contrast to the non-specific signal in the mouse. But if you use the fluorescent activatable probes, in that case it's much more clear, and you are just seeing the fluorescence when the aptamer is bind to its target. Aptamer have also been used to address super paramagnetic iron oxide nanoparticles to make MRI imaging. In that case, they use hybridization procedure where an oligonucleotide was conjugated to the spion nanoparticle before hybridization with the aptamer that was elongated, and this aptamer was targeting a prostate specific antigen. And they could see a nice T2 contrast imaging that was really higher in contrast with the constriction with the aptamer with another constriction with a scrambled control oligonucleotide. Aptamer have also been used to target other nanoparticles that, for instance, another one that was targeting nucleoline. And you could see here, it was a nanoparticle that could be followed by SPECT imaging or MRI. And you could see here a highest contrast in the tumor with the aptamer in contrast to scramble sequence. Well, the image are not good, but I'm sorry. And there was a nice T2 also contrast. So the question is, are all the aptamer could be always successful for in vivo imaging? Because I present you some promising results. But in fact, it's like antibody, I think like Petit, like every other targeting agent. You could have some aptamers, like for example an aptamer that was targeting HER2, that provide very nice in vitro results with a KD around 30 nanomolar, but that do not provide any better tumor targeting in contrast to muscles in that case. And in our case, in our group, we developed several aptamers against different markers of cancer cells, and in the past we developed one that was targeting red proteins. And this aptamer was labeled with fluorine 18, and we do PET imaging. And in our case, even if this aptamer was working very well in vitro, it was not able to target a tumor in vivo. The tumor was here, it's impossible to see. You just see the kidney and the liver and the bladder. And what you could see also is that there was a very, very fast elimination of your aptamer. It's just 10 minutes after injection, you have a very high signal in the kidney and quite nothing in the body of the animal. So it's nice if you imagine to have a fast contrast, but as a previous talk, it's maybe too fast, and maybe we have to, in contrast to antibody where they try to reduce the size, in our case maybe it could be better to increase the size, because the clearance is really too fast in my point of view. Since all the aptamers are not working, there is another thing that have been proposed, is that since aptamers could be developed very quickly against cells, we could develop in parallel different aptamers against cancer cells. So we could generate a pool of aptamers, and we could make in vivo screening using fluorescence imaging, for example, that is easier to access, to screen which aptamer could bind cells not only in vitro but also in vivo. Using this kind of strategy, we test 10 different aptamers, and we find one, only one on 10, that was able to not only bind the cancer cells in vitro but also to provide a higher signal in a tumor comparing to a scrambled sequence. This imaging was performed by FMT, fluorescence molecular tomography. So we know that this aptamer was able to target its tumor. We know it's bind cancer cells. The only trouble is that we identify this aptamer against cancer cells, but we don't know the target. So hopefully with Aptamer, you could use the Aptamer to identify the target. In that case, we make a biotinylation of the Aptamer. We attach the Aptamer on magnetic beads. Then cancer cells were attached to the Aptamer by binding to its proteins. Then after lysis of the cells, we could extract the protein bound to the Aptamer, and we could see by electrophoresis a protein that was extracted and identified as annexin A2. And in fact, annexin A2 has been published since many years to be a good marker in some cancer. So in conclusion, there is many ways to use Aptamer for molecular imaging. It's still an emerging field of research, but the main advantage of Aptamer, it's easy to synthesize and it's easy to conjugate. So there is some promising results that have already been obtained in preclinical research, but most of this trial concern for moment tumor imaging, and I think it could be very nice if in the future some trials could be used in other pathologies such as cardiopathologies or neurodegenerative disease. There is something that you have to take care of, is that the labeling could dramatically affect the biodistribution of aptamers. And maybe two promising things for molecular imaging using Aptamer is the fact that you could develop easily fluorescent activatable probes with Aptamer that could be useful for fluorescence imaging assisted surgery. And also Aptamer are easy, it's very easy to conjugate Aptamer to nanoparticles. And I think in the field of nanotechnology, there is a high interest to have ligands to target this kind of nanoparticle, especially for MRI. So I would like to thank all the collaborators of my lab that are working with me in the field of Aptamer since many years, and I thank you for your attention.